Nations around the world will be celebrating tonight. They have been included on the Olympic programme. Those five sports are skateboarding, surfing.
What's up, guys? My name is Cale Brock. I'm a filmmaker and a surfer, and today I want to chat about how surfing in the Olympics is going to work. We've been doing a ton of research here, and I want to share that with you so that you can watch from an informed point of view. Let's jump into it. So where do the surfers come from? Well, according to the WSL, all of the qualifications actually took place in the 2019 World Tour season, obviously with the 2020 season being really sort of disrupted, and of course the actual Olympics being delayed a year. That was the season that they grabbed all the surfers. So only 18 of the 40 places at the Olympic Games were determined by that season, and the remaining places, the remaining 22 places, were determined at the 2019 and 2020 ISA World Surfing Games, and also at the 2019 Pan American Games, and also a selection by the host nation, Japan. The 18 places that are allocated at the WSL come with the condition that a country cannot qualify more than two athletes per gender. I think what's really interesting about that is that limiting it to two athletes per country per gender, so four in total, it actually makes it unfair, or I guess it disadvantages certain countries, and it benefits other countries. The countries that it would disadvantage are places like Brazil, Australia, and America, where that sort of contingent of professional surfers is quite large. The talent pool is really large, and on a talent basis, on a talent scale, these countries could probably send a lot more athletes than just two men and two women. You know, there's probably 10 to 12 athletes who are surfing at a level high enough to compete in the Olympics, whereas we look at places like Italy. I don't know, are there people from Sweden and all the rest of it? It would be pretty interesting to see who ends up representing those countries. Obviously, we've got Leo Fioravanti, who I believe is representing Italy. That's going to be really interesting to see how it plays out. What's also interesting is that Kanoa Igarashi, of course, over the last few years has sort of decided to represent Japan on an international level. I don't know whether that was like a considered decision so that he was sort of guaranteed to make the Olympics. I dare say, based on his rankings on the World Tour, that he may not have made it if he was to choose to represent America. So obviously big standout names. We've got Gabriel Medina, who's going to be an absolute force regardless of the conditions. He's a competitive beast. We've got Italo Ferreira, obviously the world champ in 2019. JJF, obviously John's an interesting one, and they've been kind of documenting his journey coming back from injury. Based on the surfing that I've seen, he doesn't look to be surfing at full capacity. Based on the footage though, it's still obviously pretty impressive. So it'll be interesting to see how that plays out, whether he's coming back too soon from that knee, or whether, you know, he is actually feeling strong and ready to go. From Australia, we've got Owen Wright and Julian Wilson. Even though those two are incredible surfers, I can't see them placing up in the top three. Unfortunately, but hey, I would love to be proven wrong. With the girls, we've got Steph Gilmore from Australia, probably my favourite female surfer. It'd be really cool to see her in some good waves. If the waves are small, she might not struggle, but I don't think she'll stand out as much. But based on the forecast, I've seen that it looks like there's a typhoon swell coming, which is pretty exciting. Carissa Moore, she's obviously going to be very hard to beat, representing USA. Silvana Lima from Brazil, obviously, again, I don't think she'll match those two aforementioned names, though. Carolyn Marks will be definitely a force to reckon with, and Tatiana Weston-Webb as well. It's going to be interesting. So where is everyone surfing? I don't know if I'm going to butcher this, but it's Suryagarsky Surfing Beach. It seems like there's going to be a bit of a swell running, which is pretty cool. The beach is located in Ichinomiya town. Ideally, the waves will have enough punch in size. Again, what I spoke about previously, it looks like there's a typhoon swell coming. I saw a post from Chris Cote or Surfline, I think it was, that showed some pretty solid swell lines, which is pretty exciting. This obviously leads to the discussion around whether to do the event in a wave pool or do it in the ocean. Obviously, over the past couple of weeks, we've seen the release of the new surf stadium in Japan. utilizing the perfect swell wave pool technology, arguably one of the best wave pool technologies from what I've seen in terms of wave quality. I haven't got to surf it, but that would naturally even the playing field for all the surfers, which is probably more in line with the Olympic ethos, I would say, is giving everyone equal opportunity to perform. Now, that also takes away a certain element from inherent surf culture, which, you know, involves reading the ocean, putting yourself in the best spot possible, which is definitely a skill that comes into play in all sorts of contests, as well as luck. So, depending on the actual sort of philosophy of the Olympics, are we going to allow luck to play a part in determining who takes out the event? Well, it seems like that is going to be the case, because there looks like there's going to be some really nice waves at the beach. So that'll be interesting. I'd love to see whether they actually also take some of the event to the wave pool or not. Yeah, it'd be cool to see. Okay, let's have a look at the format. So even seasoned surf fans may need a little bit of a primer for the format. It's going to be different from the typical WSL events. For the Olympics, there will be 6 rounds of 30-minute heats, which feature a mix of 5 and 4 surfer heats and one-on-one rounds to narrow the field of 20 men and 20 women down. Heats 1 and 2 are made of 4 and 5 surfers. Heat 3 and beyond is 1-on-1. In round 1, the first round is non-elimination. Surfers will be seeded into 5 heats of 4 surfers each, with the top 2 surfers advancing straight to round 3. The bottom 2 surfers will be seeded into round 2, the first elimination round. So this is kind of similar to Kelly's format, which the WSL adopted in recent years, where basically they can condense the event window by doing that. So by sending surfers straight to round 3 if they win. In round 2, that's obviously the elimination round. The second round will include 2 heats of 5 surfers each. The top 3 surfers of each heat will advance, while the bottom 2 surfers will be eliminated from the competition. The big elephant in the room right here is we jump back to these high density heats. And what I mean by that is a typical heat on the WSL is 2 surfers, 1-on-1, which is arguably much more fair when you're surfing in the ocean, because you sort of allocate 50% of the waves to one surfer, 50% to the other. If you chuck in 5 surfers in a heat, in an elimination heat, mind you, it's going to get pretty scrappy. That's only 20% of the waves for each surfer. So it's going to be quite interesting. Again, the advantage of doing it in a wave pool would be that if you had 5 surfers, they all get the same wave each. So it wouldn't, you know, be such a scrappy sort of rushed competition. They are 30-minute heats, which is a lot of time. But again, this is going back to that QS format. If you've ever watched QS's qualifying series events compared to World Tour events, they're just very busy. The quality of surfing is a little bit lower, and not just because of the surfers, I would say because of, you know, they don't have that luxury of waiting around for excellent waves. So that's going to be really interesting to see. Round 3, surfers will be seeded into 8 heats of 2 surfers each. Yep, so 1-on-1. The surfer who places first moves through, while the surfer who places second is eliminated, and so on until the final. Okay, so typical sort of event format for that. Each wave, surfers can catch as many waves as they want. And on those waves, they receive a score of 0 to 10. And of course, only the top 2 waves are counted. It's going to be interesting to see how this plays out. Okay, the judges. I mean, if we look at the judges, obviously we couldn't have like just random people jumping on board here. They needed surfing experts. So as far as I can see, they've pulled out a lot of the WSL judges from their jobs for the time at the Olympics. The panel includes a technical director, so I guess someone just overseeing the logistical applications of scoring and all the rest of it. Contest director, who's going to make all the calls regarding waves, where to surf, and all the rest of it, and 11 judges. 2 head judges, 7 judges, and 2 priority judges, which is, again, with 5-person heats, that's going to be really key. It's going to be just a bit of a rainbow, that priority scorecard. It's going to be just changing colours all the time, which is going to be very hard to manage. Importantly, The judges come from 7 countries across 4 continents, so obviously trying to eliminate any bias there. But again, judges are pretty spot on these days. Sometimes. Okay, so the obvious, the attributes that are going to be judged are pretty standard across surfing and very similar to the WSL: commitment and difficulty, innovation and progression, combinations, speed, power, flow. So if we look at commitment and difficulty there, obviously if someone goes up and does a massive air reverse at the start of the wave, shows a lot of commitment, a lot of difficulty, and then does a little lip line to finish off, that's going to score more points than if they did a little lip line to start with and an air reverse at the end of the wave, because it's less risky. Innovation and progression, well, basically just what I said, are the athletes pushing the sport and really pushing the boundaries of performance? Are they, you know, if someone like Philippe Toledo, when he gets in that zone and he does those massive full rotation airs, that's an example of pushing progression and really innovating, you know, alley-oops, full rotations and all that sort of stuff. And that's why I think the Brazilians, you know, Italo and Gabriel, I think it sucks that Philippe's not competing, because he would be such a giant killer. But again, Italo and Gab, when they do those airs, I think it's going to be pretty easy for them to score high. But of course, they can't get away with just doing those same turns over and over again, because variety is also a consideration. Combination, that means just linking those terms together. Speed, power, flow. How do you link those terms together? How do you make it look overall, aesthetically, on the wave? And of course, similar to the other sports in the Olympics, like I guess gymnastics and ice skating stuff, there is a subjective element to the judging process, which is going to be quite interesting to see. So there you go, that's the approach that the Olympics are going to take to surfing this year. It's pretty exciting to see surfing has finally reached a stage where it is included in the Olympics. I think there's going to be across the board some different sort of sentiment there. Some people will find it a little bit lame, some people will be super excited that it's on the big stage. Regardless, what we're going to see is a big surge in interest in the sport. Whether or not that translates to increased participation or not, I don't know, but it's certainly going to be interesting to see. Thank you so much for tuning in, guys. I hope you enjoyed this video. What are you guys most excited about with surfing in the Olympics? Do you like that it's in the Olympics or not? Let me know in the comments down below. You can also join me on Instagram @KalesBroccoli. I'll see you guys soon.